So we were studying about coordinate geometry in case of complex number. We have already seen how we can find angle between two intersecting vectors in case of complex number. We even saw how we can rotate a complex number by an angle theta in the argon plane by multiplying it by e to the power iota theta or e to the power minus iota theta. The next thing that we have seen under this topic is how we can shift origin in case of complex number. And the last thing that we have studied is how we can find inverse of a point with respect to a straight line and with respect to a circle. So the next topic that we are going to study under this topic, that is coordinate geometry for complex number, is dot products and cross products. So we already know that in case of real numbers, that is real vectors, we can define dot product of two vectors, say A and B. We always say A dot B is mod of A into mod of B into cos theta. And in case of cross product, we say A cross B is mod B into sin theta. Similarly, let us use the same definition for complex number, and we say, we define Z1 into Z2, that is dot product of Z1 and Z2, as mod of Z1 into mod of Z2 into cos theta, and say Z1 cross Z2, that is cross product of Z1 and Z2, as mod of Z1 into mod of Z2 into sin theta. Now let us try to derive a general formula for dot and cross product of complex numbers. So let us say Z1 is represented by A1 plus iota B1, and Z2 is represented by A2 plus iota of B2. And the angle between Z1 and Z2 be theta. So when I try to represent them on argon plane, if I say this is my argon plane and this is my vector Z1 and this is Z2 and this is angle theta between them. So I can always apply Konai theorem here and say that Z2 upon Z1, I can write, separating this completely, I can write Z2 upon Z1 as mod of Z2 upon mod of Z1 into e to the power iota theta. I am multiplying both the sides. I am multiplying the numerator and denominator LHS by Z1 bar. So what I get here is Z2 upon Z1 into Z1 bar. Z1 bar, this equals to mod of Z2 upon mod of Z1 into e to the power iota theta. This is nothing but equal to Z1 bar into Z2 mod of Z1 square is equals to mod Z2 mod Z1 e to the power iota theta. Taking Z1 bar mod of Z1 square here, I get Z1 bar Z2 is mod of Z1 into mod of Z2, and I can always write e to the power iota theta is cos theta plus sin theta. So this is equals to cos theta plus iota sin theta. Expanding this completely, what I have, Z1 bar into Z2 is equals to mod of Z1 cos theta plus iota mod of Z2 into sin theta. So what I get from here is that the real part of Z1 bar into Z2, what I get from here is that the real part of mod Z1 bar into Z2, this is mod Z1 Z2 cos theta, which is nothing but the dot product of Z1 and Z2. and the imaginary part of z1 bar z2 is mod z1 z2 sin theta, which is equals to cross product of z1 z2. So I can define from here is that z1 into z2 is equals to real part of z1 bar z2, and z1 cross z2 is equals to imaginary part of z1 cross z2. Now if I put value of z1 and z2 as a1 plus iota b1 and a2 plus iota b2, I get real part of z1 bar z2 as a1 a2 plus b1 b2, and the imaginary part of z1 bar z2 as a1 b2 minus a2 b1. So this is the general formula that we can derive for dot product and cross product of any two complex number. Now let us try to derive some more properties related to the dot product and cross product of complex number. So if I say I have two complex numbers z1 and z2 which are perpendicular, in this case my dot product is going to be 0. So let us say, define some properties. The first property is, if z1 and z2 are perpendicular, then z1 dot product of z1 and z2 is 0. The second property is, if z1 and z2 are parallel, then what? This sin theta, that this theta would be 0 or pi. This implies that cross sin theta would be 0. This implies the cross product of z1 cross z2 is 0. We say z1 cross z2 is 0. Third, the projection of z1 and z2, that is the projection of z1 on z2, would be z1 cos theta. So projection of z1 on z2 is z1 cos theta, which is equals to, we already know that we know that z1 into z2 is nothing but mod z1 cos theta. So this is going to be z1 into z2 divided by mod z2. Similarly, projection of z2 on z1 would be z2 cos theta, which is nothing, z1 dot z2 upon mod of z1. The fourth property is, if z1 and z2 are sides of a triangle, in case of real numbers we used to say that the area of a triangle can be even determined by half of a1 into a2 sin theta, where a1 and a2 used to represent the sides of a triangle. Similarly, in case of complex number, if z1 and z2 are the sides of a triangle, we can always say that the area of the triangle would be half of mod of z1 into z2 sin theta, and z1 into z2 sin theta is nothing but z1 cross z2. So if z1 and z2 are sides of a triangle, the area of a triangle, the area of that triangle, you can say area of triangle would be always equals to half z1 cross z2. Similarly, if z1 and z2 are the sides of a parallelogram, then the area of that parallelogram would be z1 cross z2 sin theta, which is nothing but cross product of z1 and z2. So if z1 and z2 are sides of a parallelogram,
then the area of parallelogram is Z1 cross Z2. And the last property is, if Z1 and Z2 are the diagonals of a parallelogram, in that case the area of the parallelogram would be half of mod of Z1 Z2 sin theta, which is nothing but half of Z1 cross Z2. So we say if Z1 and Z2 are diagonals of a parallelogram, then I should write this even as area, then area of parallelogram is half Z1 cross Z2. I'm repeating all the properties once again. The first property is Z1 and Z2 are perpendicular, then we can always say that their dot product is 0, and similarly if Z1 and Z2 are parallel, we will say that their cross product is always 0. The third property is projection of Z1 and Z2 is nothing but Z1 cos theta, which is equals to Z1 dot Z2 upon mod of Z2. If Z1 and Z2 are sides of a triangle, then the area of the triangle would be half of Z1 cross Z2. And since area is always positive, I can even say that to be half of mod of Z1 cross Z2. If Z1 and Z2 are sides of a parallelogram, in that case the area of that parallelogram would be Z1 cross Z2, or more specifically mod of Z1 cross Z2. And if Z1 and Z2 are sides of a parallelogram, diagonals of a parallelogram, in that case the area of that parallelogram would be half of Z1 cross Z2. I hope everyone is comfortable with all these properties related to dot product and cross product. Now let us solve one question so that we can apply this concept more easily. I am just rubbing the left side. Let us say we have two complex numbers, Z1 equals to 2 plus 5 iota and Z2 equals to 3 minus iota. Now we have to find the dot product and cross product of these two complex numbers. Then Z1 dot Z2 would be A1 A2 2 into 3 plus B1 B2, which is 5 into minus 1. This is equal to 6 minus 6, 0. 6 minus 5, that is 1. Z1 cross Z2 is A1 B2, A1 B2 2 into minus 1 plus a minus A2 B1 3 into 5 which is equals to 2 minus 2 minus 6 minus 2 minus 15, that is minus 17. Now let us see what would be Z2 into Z1. So Z2 into Z1. Now if we do Z2 into Z1, in this formula A1 would be A2 and A2 would be even vice versa, because we have just reversed the A1 A2. We will find if we do Z2 into Z1, it will again be 1. We can easily do it by applying the formula here. I am recognizing the answer. And Z2 cross Z1 would be plus 17. So one important thing that I want you all to observe here is Z1 cross Z2 is minus 17 and Z2 cross Z1 is plus 17. Do you remember in case of vectors, in case of real numbers, when we used to cross product of two vectors, we used to apply the right hand rule to find out the direction of the resultant vector. And we used to say, always say that Z1 cross Z2 and the direction of Z1 cross Z2 and Z2 cross Z1 used to be negative. The same thing turns, we can even observe here, where we see that Z1 cross Z2 is minus 17 and the direction of Z2 cross Z1 is just the reverse of the direction of Z1 cross Z2. So the idea here is to explain it that all the properties that used to be valid in case of real number are almost even valid in case of complex number. Now if I want to find the projection of Z1 on Z2, it would be projection of Z1 on Z2 would be Z1 cos theta, which is 1 upon mod of Z2. Mod of Z2 in case this case is 1 upon under root 10. Similarly, I can even find the projection of Z2 on Z1. So we have seen how we can apply all these formulas. We have seen how we can apply all these formulas with the help of these two complex numbers Z1 and Z2. Now, after this, let us get on to our next topic. I hope everyone is comfortable in finding the dot product and cross product of two complex numbers. Now, the next topic which we are going to discuss is how we can find distance between any two complex numbers on an Argand plane. So, let us say I have my Argand plane. On this, I have two points P and Q. P is representing vector Z1 and Q is representing vector Z2. So, you can always say that PQ vector would be defined by Z2 minus Z1. So, the modulus of PQ vector would be mod of Z2 minus Z1, which is nothing but the distance between P and Q on Argand plane. If I put Z1 as A1 plus iota B1 and Z2 as A2 plus iota B2, what I am going to get here? Is A2 minus A1 plus iota B2 minus B1. So mod of PQ vector would be nothing but mod of this vector. Now some important properties related to distance formula. What we have found here is the distance between vector Z2 and Z1. If in our case Z1 is 0, that is the distance that the distance of any complex number Z1 from origin is nothing but mod of Z. That is distance of a complex number Z from origin is nothing but mod of Z. Similarly, if I say three points Z1, Z2 and Z3 are collinear, so on Argand plane I have this is one point Z1, this is Z2 and this is Z3. For Z1, Z2 and Z3 to be collinear, very clearly mod of Z1 minus Z2 plus mod of Z2 minus Z3 has to be equal to mod of Z1 minus Z3. This is the condition for collinearity of three complex number. Let us solve one question based upon it. For example, I have three complex number Z1 equals to 3 plus 2 iota, Z2 equals to 2 minus iota and Z3 equals to minus 7 iota. We have to prove that these three complex numbers Z1, Z2 and Z3 are collinear. So using the same property, let us see what is Z1, mod of Z1 minus Z2. Mod of Z1 minus Z2 would be 1 square plus 3 square, that is under root of 10. Mod of Z2 minus Z3 would be 2 square plus minus 1 plus 7, 6 square, which is equals to under root of 40, that is 2 under root 10, and mod is Z1 minus Z2, Z2 minus Z3, mod of Z1 minus Z3 would be 3 square plus 2 plus 7, 9 square.
that is under root of 90, that is 3 root 10.
So what I get from here is mod of z1 minus z2 plus mod of z2 minus z3 is equals to 3 root 10, which is equals to mod of z1 minus z3. Thus I can say that these three points z1, z2 and z3 are collinear. So the next topic that we are going to discuss after distance formula is how we can find perpendicular bisector of any line joining two complex number z1 and z2. We have already seen a similar case of perpendicular bisector while finding the inverse of two complex number, where we used to say that perpendicular bisector is nothing but a line. After distance formula, the next topic that we are going to discuss is how we can find perpendicular bisector of any line that is joining two complex number z1 and z2. See, perpendicular bisector. See, I have two complex number z1 and z2. And let this line be their perpendicular bisector. Then according to the property of perpendicular bisector, any point R, say it is represented by fxz, then the distance of any point R lying on this line should be equal from z1 and z2. That is, we can say that any point R lying on this line is equidistant from z1 and z2. So using distance formula, I can always write mod of z minus z1 is equals to mod of z minus z2. Once again, by the property of perpendicular bisector, I can always say that any point lying on the perpendicular bisector would be equidistant from z1 and z2. I am applying the same property here and telling that mod of z minus z1 is equals to mod of z minus z2. So what I get here, I am squaring these two sides and I am writing mod z square as z into z bar. So z minus z1 into z minus z1 bar is equals to z minus z2 into z minus z2 bar. On solving this, I will get an equation of this form. Z into z1 bar minus z2 bar plus z bar into z1 minus z2 is equals to mod of z1 square minus mod of z2 square. This is the general formula of perpendicular bisector of any line, of a perpendicular bisector of any line that is joining z1 and z2. Now let us solve one question based upon this, or let us try to apply this formula on a question. For example, I have z1 as a point 3 plus 4 iota and z2 as a point minus 5 plus 6 iota. So z1 is represented by point 3 plus 4 iota and z2 is represented by point minus 5 plus 6 iota. And we have to find the perpendicular bisector of a line joining z1 and z2. Let us apply the same formula. The perpendicular bisector would be z into z1 bar, that is 3 plus 4 iota, minus z2 bar, that is minus 5 plus 6 iota, plus z bar into z1 minus z2. z1 is 3 plus 4 iota minus z2. z2 is minus 5 plus 6 iota. This is equals to mod of z1 square minus mod of z2 square. Mod of z1 square is 3 square plus 4 square and mod of z2 square is 5 square plus 36, sorry, 5 square plus 6 square, that is 36. So when I solve this, I will get something of the form z into 8 plus 2 iota
plus z bar 8 minus 2 iota is equals to 36.
This is the general formula, sorry, this is equals to minus 36 because there is a minus sign here. This is the equation of the perpendicular bisector of line joining Z1 and Z2, and we have derived it using this general formula. The next topic that we are going to discuss is how we can find, how we can apply section formula in case of complex numbers. So we have seen how we can derive the general equation of a perpendicular bisector of any line that is joining two complex numbers Z1 and Z2. The next topic that we are going to discuss now is how we can apply section formula in case of complex numbers.
So the next topic is section formula.
So if we have two complex numbers Z1 and Z2, then the coordinate of any complex number Z that is dividing the line joining Z1 and Z2 in the ratio of M1 and M2 would be given by. So in this case we are going to have two cases. First, if Z is internally dividing Z1 and Z2, and the second case when Z is externally dividing Z1 and Z2. So let us see the first case.
When if this is Z1 and this is Z2 and this is a point Z which is internally dividing Z1 and Z2
in the ratio of M1 and M2. Then in case the coordinate of the point Z would be given by M1 into Z2. The same way we used to apply section formula in case of real numbers, we are doing it in the case of complex number. It is M1 into Z2 plus M2 into Z1 upon M1 plus M2. And the second case is when Z is externally dividing Z1 and Z2. So if this is M1, Z1, this is Z2, and this is a point Z which is externally dividing Z1 and Z2 in the ratio of M1 and M1 is to M2, then we say coordinate of Z are M1 into Z2 minus M2 into Z1 upon M1 minus M2. I'll write this even with a yellow. Again, the coordinate of Z is M1 into Z2 minus M2 into Z1 M1 minus M2. These are the two ways in which we can apply section formula in case of complex number. Say I have a triangle whose coordinates are Z1, Z2 and Z3, and I've been given that the circumcenter of this triangle is origin. We are given that circumcenter is origin and Z is the orthocenter for this triangle. Once again, we are given a triangle whose coordinates are Z1, Z2 and Z3. We are given that the circumcenter of this triangle is origin and the orthocenter of this triangle is Z. We have to find relation between Z1, Z2 and Z3. Now, we know that in case of any triangle, the orthocenter, centroid and circumcenter are collinear, and the centroid divides orthocenter and centroid, a circumcenter, in the ratio of 2:1. This is something we have already studied in case of triangles. This is the property that applies for all type of triangles. The orthocenter, centroid and circumcenter are collinear, and any point centroid divides orthocenter and circumcenter in the ratio of 2:1, that is the line joining orthocenter and circumcenter in the ratio of 2:1. Now for this triangle with coordinates Z1, Z2 and Z3, the orthocenter, the centroid, the coordinate of centroid would be Z1 plus Z2 plus Z3 by 3, We already know that the circumcenter is origin, that is its coordinates are 0, and we have been given that the fx of the orthocenter is z. So applying section formula, I can write z1 plus z2 plus z3 divided by 3 is equals to 2 into 0 plus 1 into z upon 2 plus 1. Solving this, what I get is z1 plus z2 plus z3 is equals to z. This is the relation between z1, z2, z3 and the orthocenter for the triangle. Now let us observe the section formula once again. We know that z equals to m1 z2 plus m2 z1 upon m1 plus m2. So by using this formula, we can say that the midpoint of the line joining z1 and z2 in this case m1 is 2, m1 and m2 would be 1. So the midpoint of the of any line joining z1 and z2 would be z1 plus z2 by z1 plus z2 divided by 2. This is the special case for section formula.